The intro video was the logo for the human perspective, with purple and orange concentric circles swirling around a photo of Judy Human. The intro fades into a video interview between Judy Human and Susan Reinhard with an orange border. Judy Human is a white woman with short brown hair and glasses. She uses a motorized wheelchair and is wearing a button-down shirt with blue, green, purple, and yellow floral designs. Behind her is the dining room of her home. Susan Reinhard is a white woman with shoulder-length red hair with bangs. She is wearing a white shirt with an open button-down top with gold, red, and black paisley print, small hoop earrings, and a gold necklace. She is seated in front of a blurred background.
Hello, everybody. Welcome back to The Human Perspective. Today, our guest is Susan Reinhard, who is the Senior Vice President of the American Association of Retired Persons, otherwise known as AARP, in charge of their Institute on Public Policy. Welcome to our program, Susan.
Thanks, Judy. I've really been looking forward to this.
What made you decide to go into nursing in the first place?
I really like the idea of working with people directly. So rather than, you know, become a physician, which you don't get as much interaction on a regular basis. And I particularly wanted community health nursing. So that's why I'm so deeply rooted in home and community-based services. My very first job as a nurse was in the Veterans Administration Hospital in East Orange. Then I went into a visiting nurse role.
What did you like about that? What did you learn from it?
Once you ring that doorbell or knock on the door and somebody opens it and you cross that threshold, they are in charge. This is their home. You are a guest, and then you're going to leave and they're still there. So their health and wellness and disability and everything is where people live. And that came through really, really very early in my nursing career. And so what could I do in the relatively brief time I had with people to support what they needed, what their goals are, what they really wanted, and what resources could I bring to the table? Because really, it's not me. It's really after I leave, what's going to help them?
So how long did you work in the field?
So I worked as a visiting nurse for maybe about 3 years, and then I got a master's degree so I could teach. So one of the most interesting times was when I would teach nurses, they're already nurses, who were going back to get a baccalaureate degree. And I have to tell you, they were like a little alarmed about going into homes. You know, what am I going to talk about? How do I do this? So it was very interesting to see that this is a different environment, but it should be in every nurse's head. Every healthcare and social care professional should be very centered on the person and the person's family and where they live. That's so hard to get across, though.
Unless you're living it. And I think, you know, the perspective that you come into this work is that people live a life and that you're really there to help them piece together different things. When did you stop doing nursing in people's homes?
I started understanding that you can give support care one at a time, but that if you're really going to help, policy is one route to do it. I was a pretty new visiting nurse, and I went to one patient's home and I was able to order orthopedic shoes. So the next, you know, maybe it was a month or two later, I was in a similar situation and I called my nursing supervisor and I said, I think this person needs orthopedic shoes too. And she said, look at the bottom of the chart and look where it says payment and look at the boxes. And the boxes could be Medicare, Medicaid, veterans, Blue Cross, Blue Shield, private pay, some other insurance, et cetera. And she said, this one doesn't have the right box checked. That was life-changing for me. It really sunk in that my practice and my ability to support people was affected by payment, and that could only be changed through policy. And so advocacy was really new to me. How do you get more people on board and form coalitions and work with legislators? And so I was doing that for quite a while and then eventually was recruited to work for a governor.
When you think about the legislative process, what changes do you think have or have not gone on within legislators' thinking about issues, for example, around the importance of home and community-based services?
More people have experienced it themselves either because they have a family member or an older, and maybe their parent, who really, you know, something happened. And so more and more legislators, you don't have to tell them this because they have this experience. They don't know what to do about it. For Medicaid, we still have a nursing home entitlement. That's what you get, a nursing home. You don't automatically get access to home and community-based services, but we've shifted it. And that's been since the 80s. Now, a lot of it has to occur at the state level. So, you know, you'll see legislators that were state, they worked in states and then they're elected to Congress and, you know, they joined different caucuses. And so it's, you know, you're learning more and more. But again, most of that funding is directed at the states, but in Medicaid, there's the federal match. So there are these policy levers, we like to call them. There are ways to increase the match. And that's what's happening now, that, oh goodness, if we could do more increase, we have a 10% increase right now as an incentive for states to increase the home and community-based services. Connecticut, they have been estimating through data, how many people will be needing home and community-based care over time. And they've been doing this for, I don't know, 15 years, and they've been going into the future so that they could prepare. And it's been about 2% change a year, which is double what the national average is. So that's really good. They went from where they were to 2029. That's such a shift from institutional care to home care, jumped them 8 years ahead. And that meant they were short 10,000 home care workers. That's what they would need for 2029. These were all their projections. Like, on top of that, well, they were losing workers, right? So workforce has become, not that it shouldn't have been before, but such a huge priority. And I think Congress and state legislators are getting that we are beyond crisis.
Yeah, I mean, as one who uses personal assistance in the home, it's a crisis, which maybe leads us a little bit into, most people hope to become older. And statistically, we understand disability increases as we get older. And yet it's been difficult to have meaningful discussions with people in their 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s to look at disability as something which is normal, and to be preparing for it. Do you feel that it's important for a larger number of people who may not yet have disabilities, as well as those who have acquired disabilities, to be engaged in this discussion?
I absolutely do. And first of all, people don't want to think about anything difficult happening to them in the future. I think that's human nature. You want to be positive. And so we have this document and we call it Prepare to Care, and it is online. But it gets to exactly your question, like, how do you have this conversation? How do you create a plan? How do you start thinking about it? And the most important thing is to really go from what the person's goals are, not, we need to get you into another place. We need to move you here. We need to do this for you, right? It's more, let's talk. As you're doing this, let's say I'm the daughter and I'm talking to my mother, it is making me aware too. The more you do that, the more it goes down through the ages, right? One of the things, it just amazes me that people don't think about it, is where you live. How accessible is it? And by the way, it's not just if you have a disability or you're aging. People have accidents. Even if you want to have someone visit you, you want to make it possible for someone to visit you that might have a disability, even if it's temporary, you're going to have to make sure they can get in the house and they can use the bathroom and they can, you know, get in.
Many of the points that you're raising are so very critical. You know, we talk to people who are older, who weren't doing any planning, and their homes are not accessible. How is AARP working to try to get people to live the vision that you're discussing? Getting people to be proactive instead of reactive, when we know that being reactive frequently means it's not going to benefit the person, maybe mm-hmm. in the future, but not now.
So we've created what we call the long, it's a big name, right? Long-term services and support state scorecard. And we started this more than 10 years ago. I think it was like 2009, with a vision. So we've just been talking about access, but it's not accessibility, it's more financial access. Like, how do you get in? What do we have to support family caregivers? And what about quality? And then we have the transitions, you know, how do states do in helping people leave nursing homes, for example? So we have like 26 data points that we've been tracking over time. We do a lot around home and community-based services, How are states spending the money? What is the availability of assisted living, for example? What is the supply of home health aides? It's hard, you know, you don't have data for everything. That's the real issue. So you have to have data that all the states collect, et cetera. So that's a limiting factor. But we have employment. And this came from the disability community from the very beginning, that we wanted to look at employment within quality, that's part of quality of life. So we're tracking the ratio of employment of working age adults who have an ADL disability over those that don't. So the highest percent that we have found is 30%. And that's in Minnesota and Nevada. So there's an example of, okay, we're going to give you the data. Now, could advocates in that state, those states, in any state, determine why? Are there policies that are helping with this? Is there a better use of the ADA, you know, against discrimination of people with disabilities? Is that governor or legislature taking that more positively? Is there private industry that is doing that? I don't really know. I would like to know, though. Self-direction is another one. So self-direction is a term that really comes from the disability community. In fact, your paper years ago, Judy, I read it, understand it. You were making the point that older people can have self-direction too. It's not only younger people with disabilities. And that really affected AARP, I think, years ago. Like, oh, maybe we should pay attention to this. You know, what is that all about? So we do track that. What states have more programs that allow people to hire their own worker and choose what services they want, as opposed to certainly a nursing home, but even home care agencies that, you know, it's a little bit more prescriptive, I'll say, a little bit more like, here's what we have, right? This is the worker you're going to get, right? So self-determination is something we're tracking in the scorecard too. And that varies. You know, California's number one because they've been doing it for, I don't know, 30 plus years.
How do you think we can move more collaboratively together between the disability community, which has older people in it, obviously, and the younger generation of disabled people and AARP and others? How do we really launch a campaign which allows people to look at planning for your future?
I always feel the disability community has infused your independent living philosophies, tenets, principles into the aging world. People didn't say person-centered care very much. It just wasn't, mm-hmm. or self-determination, and not just the words, but the meanings behind the words. So the disability community, in my mind, has influenced the aging community profoundly, at least the advocacy world. Mm-hmm. Now, are we doing enough together? No. I can tell you that AARP is going to be doing more together throughout our organization and looking at health and financial equity. There's a real passion, I would say, for looking at multicultural populations and including disability. We have a lot. We have an AARP litigation group that does a lot of work on discrimination based on disabilities, Olmstead work, big case in DC, lots of things. We have a policy book that talks about, you know, access to Social Security, disability benefits, and certainly home and community-based services. Our advocacy is very much focused on aging and disability.
What do you hope as it pertains to the American Rescue Plan?
I work with someone, Brian Burwell, his name is. He said this is the most money he has ever seen in his entire career. And I agree with him. It is. Unfortunately, it's money, that particular pot of money is only available for 3 years. But still, it's a lot of money and you can address it for infrastructure, as they say, for things that can be fixed. And there's a lot of things that that could go for. I mean, you can certainly give bonuses to workers. You can do things. States are worried about getting overcommitted and will they have the funding later? But there's things you can do now that would have long-lasting effects. So we are working very hard. You can imagine our advocacy at both the national and state levels is completely dedicated to this.
So as our program is winding down, what are some messages that you'd like to give to our audience?
Well, first of all, I want to thank them and thank you for having me on and to encourage people to keep speaking up. We have to keep saying what is needed. This is a very important time to weigh in, talk to your congresspeople, your legislators about what is possible and what is needed and how it affects your lives. Congress, you know, legislators in general, they do like stories. We give data. That's my job. Lots of data, right? But we need the stories to humanize the data or the data to back up your stories. They got to go together. So don't be shy about speaking up.
Yeah, and I completely agree. It's one of the reasons we started doing the human perspective is to get people's stories forward. Stories in regard to what we're discussing today, like home and community-based services, for people who've lived in institutions or who've been at the threat of living in institutions, being able to talk about how their lives are different by being able either to move out of institutions and live in the community or stay out of institutions and using data that you're discussing through the long-term scorecard. I think these are all very promising approaches. So Susan, thank you so much for giving us this time. I've learned a lot and I look forward to working with you more in the future.
Thank you. And I learned a lot too. Thank you. I had no idea some of what you'd mentioned. So thank you.
Thank you.
That history won't forget us, our tragedy in eyes are pain, and so I.